So guys, today let us start with unit 2 and get started with data types and variables in Python. Okay, so let me share my screen and open up Visual Studio Code. Hope all of you are able to see my screen.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, guys. So what I have opened is the editor Visual Studio Code, right? And today, let us talk about variables and data types. Let us get an introduction to what variables are, what are the different inbuilt data types available in Python, right? And how you can use them. Okay, so before we see an example of the different types that are available, right? Can you guys tell me what a variable is, or what do you mean by a variable?
A container to store a value, sir.
A container to store a value. Okay. Any other definitions?
Something which does not have a fixed value.
Exactly. So it is essentially a container to store a value that can be changed throughout or during the course of the program, right? So it essentially does not have any fixed value. The value of that particular variable may be changed. Okay, so that is called as a variable. Variable is something that varies, right? Hence the name variable. Okay, and what are types, guys?
It describes what kind of data the variable carries.
Yeah, it describes the kind of data the variable or the container holds. Okay. And in Python, right, there are built-in types available, right? And Python is also extensible so that you can create your own types. Since I have already said in the previous class, Python is an object-oriented programming language, and hence Python is an extensible language. And because of this extension, you can also create your own types, right? Creating our own types using this particular extension mechanism is beyond the scope of our syllabus. We will be confining ourselves with the built-in types for this particular course, right? And Python has got the following types built-in, right? They are integers, floating point numbers, string, boolean, and the none type. All right, so let us see an example through a simple Python program, right? So as I've already mentioned, even if you write a simple hello world program or a complex program, right? Any program that you write, it is always better, or make it explicit to have your name is equal to main check, right? So let us create a file under this particular folder, 02types. Called as test.py, and ensure that we are in the proper location, which is the directory 02types. The directory 02types. So I can do a pwd, and in fact I am in 02types. Okay, so now that I am in the correct location, right, now from this particular location I can start writing my Python program, right? So let us understand variables and the built-in types. All right, so let me start with the program, right? So if name is equal to main is my first statement that I need to write, right? And if this condition is true, I call the function main, and then above I define a function main and do something, right? Okay, so what we are going to understand or learn is we are going to understand what variables are, right? So let us create a variable, say for example k, and have a value, say 10. All right, and then let us print the value of k, right? So it's a very simple program, right? So here you call main, right, ensuring that this is the main executable program that you will be running, right? And within the main function, you assign a value 10 to the variable k. Now this is your container k, right? and then you are printing k, right? So it should be an easy guess. So what is the output of this program?
10, sir.
10. Okay, so Python test.py, right? As you said it right, the value is 10.
So just a doubt, sir.
Yeah.
Why are we checking if name equal to main?
You are checking if name is equal to main to ensure that, or you are explicitly telling that this is the program that I am going to execute. You are explicit.
Okay. So without that, it will run, right?
Yeah, without that, it is going to run. So that is implicit. So see. Amongst others, one of the zens of Python is, as you can see here, somewhere, yeah, second zen, explicit is better than implicit, right? So what we are doing here is we are following the best practice and we are explicit, right? Now, the idea here is, as I've already discussed and explained in the previous class, right? If you want this particular program to be used as a library, you will not specify these two lines.
Sir, some of them waiting in waiting room, sir.
Some of them are waiting. Yeah, I have admitted them. Okay, so that is the need for this particular check if name is equal to main. Okay, now let us have another print. This time let me print the type of k, right? So what do you think the output will be now, guys?
Integer, right? Yeah.
Integer.
10 and integer.
Can you specify the complete thing that will be printed? Is it like integer?
Int,
is it just int?
It's class integer.
Yeah, it will say it is of type int, right? So it is, it will explicitly say that as class int. Okay, so as you can see here, there is a typo. Thanks for correction. So if I run it again, right, as you can see here, it is of type integer, right? So everything is an object. So 10 is an integer. Okay, so what are the other types that are available? We have float, string, bool, and nested. Okay, so let us explore these as well. So if I do or just change this to a 0.0, right,
it will become a float.
It will become a float, right? So what will be the output?
Float.
It's going to be class float. Right, then we have stir, right? So stir is nothing but
string,
right? So if I express this number within quote, single quote or double quote, we'll talk more and understand more about strings later, but this is how you represent a string, either single quote or double quote. Even there is a triple quote, we'll understand those things later, but for now I have represented this 10 as a string, right? So what will be the output here? So it is going to be class str. And there is a bool, right? And we have a none type as well. So let us look into that. So bool is nothing but you're checking. Yeah, it's 0 or 1, or in Python it is true or false, right? You check for a particular condition to be true or false. It is used in logical tests and other areas, right? So you can specify true. And if you run this, it says class bool. So this is a boolean type, right? And if you say false, right, it is also a boolean type, right? True and false both are boolean, right? And there is one more, right, which is something called as none, right? None represents the absence of a value, right? similar to null in some other languages. In Python, it is none, right? And the class type is none type, as you can see here, right? So guys, these are the built-in types that are available in Python that we will be making use of throughout the rest of our journey in the language.
Sir, actually, I have a doubt. Don't we have to mention the type while writing the program? Or yeah, can we just mention type of with brackets?
That's a very, very good question, right? Python, as we will see, in fact, when we come to this particular point, I thought of mentioning that. But since you have raised this particular question, let me tell you, Python is both dynamic and strong. Okay, when you say Python is more dynamic and strong, right? Let me start with the first one, right? Python is dynamic. So when you say Python is dynamic, as you can see here in line number 2, when I say k is equal to 10, right? As you assign the value 10, right? The interpreter, when it sees this particular value 10, right? And it assigns it to the variable k, it understands that, okay, k is some kind of numeric. It's an integer.
Okay, sir.
So this type or this kind of inferencing happens at runtime, right?
Okay, sir.
So hence the language is called as dynamic language, or Python is dynamically typed rather than statically typed. In languages like Java, C++, you explicitly say int or float or something like that, which is equal to something. So int x is equal to 10, you explicitly say that, right?
Okay, sir.
Yeah, so that is statically typed. So when you say a particular language is statically typed, right, the assignment and the understanding of the type happen during the compile time. When type happens at runtime, right, make typing.
Yes, sir.
Got it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
Okay, so since you have raised this question, let us go to this particular point and complete this point and then come back to the other points above, right? So Python is strongly typed, right? Now, what do you mean by strongly typed and what do you mean by statically typed? We just discussed about static typing and dynamic typing, right? I say that Python is strongly typed. What do you mean by this? Any guesswork? When you say Python or a language is strongly typed, right, that means that at a particular statement, when you say k is equal to 10, right, the value is int. So it is strongly typed to that particular container, or it is strongly typed to that particular container, which is of type int. Clear?
So which means it is defined in it.
Yeah, it is defined. It is defined. Like it is an integer. You cannot break it. When you say k is equal to 10, okay, I am done. It's an integer. It is strongly typed. And depending upon the assignment, you say that it is an integer. Hence, it is dynamically typed.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Fine. Now, sometimes this is also referred to as duck typing. Duck typing and dynamic typing all mean the same thing. Right? So duck typing, the name duck typing, because it's something like this. If it can walk like a duck, it is a duck. Right? So I mean to say, right? So as you can see here, now the value of k is equal to 10. Right? Now I print k, and now if I say k is equal to hello, and if I comment out this, and if I print k again, right? So this is the idea behind duck typing, right? Now it acts as an integer. Now it's an integer. K is an integer in line 2. K is a string in line 6.
Yes, sir.
Right? So this is also the concept of variable declaration and variable redeclaration. We are declaring a variable, we are redeclaring a variable at a different line, right? with a different type. So this is duck typing and variable declaration and variable redeclaration. So what is the output of this program, guys? It's going to print
10 hello.
10 hello, right? Indentation does not match. So as you can see here, there is some indentation error. So let us match this. It's okay now, right? And hello. So we have seen variables and types. We have seen the built-ins, integer, float, string, bool, none type. We talked about Python being a strongly typed language, right? It supports dynamic typing. It is not statically typed, right? Dynamic typing is also called as duck typing, right? So, yes.
Sir, then strongly typed and dynamic type, both are same, sir.
Both are related. Both are very much related.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. We talked about variable declaration, variable redeclaration, right? And yeah, with respect to strongly typed in Python, right, you also need to remember another point, right? When you concatenate strings with other types, right, in Python, you cannot do the concatenation. Right. Whereas, say, for example, this is just for an analogy. Right. If you guys are kind of little bit comfortable with JavaScript, right, in JavaScript, you can concatenate string with other types. That is possible. But in Python, it is not possible. So let us see an example. So let me take this out. And say, let me say directly have a print, right? And let me say a hello, right? Either single quote or double quote will do, right? But try to be consistent, right? And concatenation, right, is with the plus symbol, right? So concatenating a string with, say, another type, say, for example, 50.50, it's a float, right? So I am concatenating a string with a float, right? This is not supported in Python. If I try to run this now, right, it says type error, can only concatenate str to str, not float. Okay, guys? Yeah.
That is, so it can print only one type of variable.
No, here there is no variable over here. I am just printing the literal string, right, and the literal float number, and I am trying to concatenate the literal float value 50.50 along with this literal string.
Yes, sir. Got it, sir.
Got it. Everyone understood?
So can you just run this program once?
Yeah.
So this will happen in Java, sir. JavaScript.
JavaScript, yeah. JavaScript is more loose and more dynamic. It is dynamic, and it's also, see, both Python and JavaScript, they are flexible, but JavaScript is much more flexible than Python.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Now, if you want,
so yeah. Just a second. Yeah. Can you just show, like, take assign A to K, like some variable K is equal to A.
Yeah, we can do that.
So, and then k is equal to k plus 1, print k. Will that work? Like in C and C++, it will typecast automatically.
No, come again.
Assign k is equal to A.
K equal to A.
A or any letter, any character.
Are you talking about ASCII values and incrementing it?
Okay, k equal to hello, say.
That don't happen in Python.
No, not hello, sir. Some single letter.
Okay, H.
And then k is equal to k plus 1, the next line.
Okay.
then print k.
What do you think?
So in C and C++, it will add to ASCII value. Since ASCII value is an integer, it will get typecasted automatically.
Yeah, but again, here in Python, it is the same concept here. You are trying to add, right? Here, you are trying to add 1 to a string value. So it is essentially a kind of concatenation. If you run this, again, it says the same thing. Can only concatenate str to str, right?
Okay, so every time we need to explicitly state that this is an integer float while getting input if we want to, you know, like do like this.
Yeah, if you get the input, like basically whatever you type in the terminal is a string and then you need to do a typecast. But again, if you concatenate a string with any other type, it is not going to support. That is the way Python works, all right?
Okay, sir.
Okay. Now, if you want to make this work, say for example, if you want to concatenate k with 1, what can you do? You can convert 1 to a string, right? Either you can do this way, saying that it is a literal string, right? And do the concatenation, right? It says h1. Or you can make use of the constructor str. You are explicitly saying that 1 is a string. This is also equally correct.
Okay, sir. So you can convert also, sir, like string to float by typing float.
Yeah, you can do typecasting and those conversions can be done. But this is the default with respect to the concatenation aspect with respect to strings, right? You cannot combine types.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Got it. Thanks.
Sir, so one doubt.
Yeah.
Sir. So why are we doing all these in terminals, sir? Why can't we just code and run it?
Come again, what is your question? You can do the way you are comfortable with. What I'm trying to teach you is the concepts in a very readable and best practice manner. As I've already said, you can make use of IDLE, you can make use of anything. See, I can just do that here as well. I can type a Python 3, right? I get a REPL here, right? As we have already discussed, right? So this is the thing that I had been telling again and again multiple number of times. Now this is a REPL. You can test out Python's feature, each individual thing here in REPL also, right? In REPL also, you can test out Python's features. So when you test out Python's features in REPL, right? Say I want to know what is the type of print, right? It says this, right? I can say k is equal to 10. K. Now this is testing out the language's features in REPL, right? So the way that you are already that you are comfortable, you can make use of, right? You can make use of REPL. You can make use of this particular approach, right? Or whatever, right?
So using IDLE also, you will give marks, sir, normally.
Come again?
Normally in exams, if we use IDLE also, is it correct, sir?
Normally in exams, if you use IDLE, it is also correct. So my question is, in examination, in lab examination, if you are asked a Python program, this is how you are supposed to run a Python program. Whether it be IDLE, X, Y, Z, or whatever environment you choose. Am I clear?
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, how to typecast h to integer, sir?
How to typecast h to integer?
We can use order, sir, to get the ASCII value of it.
Yeah, you can use the int constructor directly.
How, sir? Code.
No, what is your question? How to typecast?
No, sir, like k is equal to assigned to h, sir. So okay. In order to get h's ASCII value, what should we do?
No, there should be some kind of built-in functions, ASCII or something like that. You just find out.
Order, sir. We have to use ORD. If you do that, ORD.
Is there a function called as ORD?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
For the ASCII value of H, huh?
Yes, sir. For ASCII value of H.
Okay. So far, so good, guys. Any other doubts with the concepts that we have seen so far?
Sir, can you repeat duck or dynamic typing?
Duck or dynamic typing is this. Right, so this is duck typing, right? At line 2, the value of k is h. At line 4, k becomes 100, right? So it is always not of the same type, right? The types could be different during different instructions or okay, during different
lines, right? Yes,
so that is duck typing, or sometimes called as dynamic typing. All right, so concatenation with other types, right, in Python can't be done, right? Let us see another concept, right, which is nothing but scope. Now, what do you mean by scope or scope of a variable?
The accessibility of a variable within that block or next.
Yeah, it is essentially the accessibility or visibility of a variable defined in the program, right? So that is called as the accessibility of a or scope of a variable, right? So in Python, we have global and local scopes. Let us try to understand that. So I have the structure defined for a Python program. Now, say for example, in order to illustrate global scope and local scope, right? Say outside main, let me have a variable k with a value 10, right? And inside main, you can play around with all this stuff, right? Using different types and other things. I'm just trying to explain the concepts. So I'm trying to explain the concept of global scope now. Say outside main, I have k is equal to 10, and within main, if I print k, right, what is the value?
10.
So this actually means that k is having global scope or local scope?
Global.
It's kind of global, right? So k is equal to 10. This is the value that is seen by any functions that you define, right? Here in this particular case, main, right? So it is 10 here. All right. Now say I call another function within main called as test. We'll talk more about functions, the return types, etc. later, but bear with me, right? Now within main, right, we are calling another function called as test, right? And outside main, let us define another function called as test, right? And within test, let me have say k is equal to SSN. Right. So what do you think the output will be now? So I'm calling main. In main, I'm calling k. And let me again, one second, print the value of k here within test.
SSN 10.
It's going to be SSN 10, right? All of you agree with this output, SSN and 10?
Yes, sir.
Okay, let us see the output. It is SSN and 10, right? Now, is this K which is available inside test, what is the visibility? This is global or local?
Local.
This is local, right? So local. Once you are done with this particular function, right, its visibility is gone, right? You are done with K, right? So this is local scope, this is global scope. This is the idea of global scope and local scope, right? Now, one more thing.
That sir, but one doubt, sir.
Yes.
We are using K two times, no, sir, so won't it get an error?
Okay, you are using K two times, right? So yes. This is global scope. Now, this is only understood by this particular function. So there is no error here. You are redefining K to a value SSN. Within this particular function, you are redefining K with the value SSN.
Okay, sir.
It is redeclaration. It is the same name K, but within test, you are saying the value is SSN. Hope I am clear.
Yes, sir.
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, how does Python know the order to print, sir? Like, why can't it print like 10 and SSN? Why just SSN and 10?
It knows the order with respect to the main entry, right? So your main entry is main, right? So the order is, it will execute from top to bottom. It will assign K is equal to 10, right? It will come to second line. Right, it is just a definition, nothing is going to be executed, right? So this part gets defined but it's not executed, this part gets defined but not executed. So the interpreter does not do anything apart from assigning 10 to K and having this definitions in memory but not executing them. And then it comes to line number 9, which does not have anything, comes to line number 10, sees this particular condition, it is true, then you make a call main, right? So this is your first execution, right? So you are calling main, right? So when you call main, it goes to the definition, you are calling test, right? So the order is you call main and then test is called. So within test, what is happening? You say K is equal to 10 and you are printing K. Already in memory, it saved K is equal to 10, right? So it redeclares K with this particular value, prints the value SSN, all right? And then it comes back to this particular part. It prints SSN. This particular function is over. Execution of this particular function is over. The control comes here, right? After which it prints K, right? Which is the global value, right? Held in memory, right? Which is having the value 10. Hence the value SSN and 10 is printed.
Sir, in the memory, it takes like how much bytes, sir? Because K is equal to 10 as 2 bytes for integer, and again K is equal to SSN as 3 bytes. So, how much bytes it will take, sir? I mean, the bits it will take, sir, the memory.
Bits or bytes, you need not worry about. We can go into that particular topics later as we see each of these things in detail. Yeah.
Sir?
Yeah?
So the main function calls the test function inside, sir.
Main function calls the test function inside. So inside main, you are calling test.
Yes, sir.
So essentially it is that way. Main function calls the test function. You are calling test within main.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Like, K is assigned. K is assigned once, sir, in this program.
Come again?
K is assigned twice, or K is declared twice, or K is declared once in this program.
K is declared once and it is redeclared.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Sir, say if we write an algorithm for this program, okay. Should I start the first statement is begin, then the second statement should be in the order in which the compiler executes it, or the order in which I have written my source code. Do you get my question, sir?
You should write the algorithm in the order in which you solve the problem.
So if I write like this, first step is begin. Next step is, should I write the compile, check if underscore name is main, and then call call the main function like that, or should I straight away start with assign k equal to 10, define test, and in that order?
No, in this particular program, it is essentially you are assigning SSN is equal to K and then printing K, which is a function call. So your order, if this is going to be an algorithm, it is the functionality available in test and what you are printing. These are the two steps, main two steps for your algorithm.
Okay, sir.
So from where we have to start, sir, our algorithm?
Your algorithm?
So from where we have to start, what should be our first step in writing the algorithm?
First step should be a begin step.
Oh. And then,
sir.
Begin step followed by the list of steps that you actually do to solve the problem. Depending upon the problem.
What I'm asking is, first I can define test, no, sir. Then I can call it, even in the algorithm, right?
Even in the algorithm, okay.
Can I call the test?
I think I can. Simplify the question, sir. Now, say I give you an algorithm, you can tell correct or not, sir. Like, after writing underscore name is main, I can tell I am calling main, and then inside main, I'm calling test, and inside test, I'm defining k and printing the values. Is this a correct sequence?
See, when you write an algorithm, your algorithm has nothing to do with the specification of name is equal to main. In your algorithm, you need not say anything about name is equal to main and all.
Oh. Okay, sir. Okay.
Hope I am clear.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So we talked about global scope and local scope, students. Now, one more point I would like to tell here is, now you can make a variable, right, having local scope here in this particular case, k is equal to SSN, right? Now, this could be made global. For example, if I do something like this, if I say global k, if I do this, right, and see the output, it is SSN now, right? So this means that a local variable, when said that it is, or it should be identified as a global one, you can override that, right, using the keyword global. So far, so good, guys. So please play around with all this, putting global, right? Having local variable, having global variables, right? Try to do some simple calculations and all. But this is the concept. Global.
Sir, is there a scope operator in Python?
It's essentially the scope operator wherein you override the visibility of a local scope to global scope.
Yes, sir. Oh, yeah. So we just have to do the global k. That
global.
Is
global
scope. Of. Okay, thank you, sir.
Correct. Okay.
Sir.
Yes.
So beside that, n is equal k is equal to 10. If you type local, that becomes local.
There is no keyword called as local.
Okay, sir.
Anything within a code block.
Can you show the global program again?
Yeah.
What is the output, sir?
What do you think the output will be?
SSN. That's okay. Then k equal to 10 will not come.
Yeah, k is equal to 10 will not come. See, the order of execution, you call test, right? So when you call test, you say that k is a global variable. So when test is called, right, interpreter assigns k to be a global variable, and it assigns the value SSN to k, and it prints k.
Okay.
After printing k, which is SSN, when you again print k from another function, right, it prints the global variable, which is SSN.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Okay.
So you don't even read k is equal to 10.
No, it reads k is equal to 10. So if this is not given, right? You get SSN and 10.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, so when you specifically say that it is global from within a function, that means that you are overriding the visibility of a local variable with a global view or global visibility.
Yes, sir.
All right.
So I add up, if is there, you declare k is equal to 10. So global k means, why don't it take k is equal to 10 itself? Why is taking k is equal to SSN? Because SSN is coming below, right?
Correct. SSN is coming below k is equal to 10. Now this particular statement makes 10 a global variable, but you're overriding this particular definition with the value SSN with this particular statement, global k.
Okay, sir. Yeah, that's it.
Hope you understand.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Sir, I have a doubt.
Yeah.
Inside the main definition, if I write print k before the test, before calling the test, what will be the output, sir?
Yeah, we can do that. So, guess what?
Will it be 10?
It is going to be 10. Yeah, because at this particular point, right, k is 10 only, right? Test is not called. So from within test only, you are assigning or overriding the value or making it global. So if you run this, yes, it is 10. 10 SSN, SSN.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sir, I have a doubt, sir. If there is not a global k and I want that value SSN inside the main print k, how to get that, sir?
Come again, if you don't have this.
If you don't have, I want the print k inside the main function as SSN.
Print k as SSN here, you can redefine, you can have a local variable k is equal to SSN here.
Oh, again, I should do that.
Yeah, yeah. So it all depends, right? So play around with all this particular stuff, see the output, what actually you get. But this is the concept.
I can't get that from the test function also, like test.k means I'll get that from.
You cannot say test.k, test itself is a function, right?
Sir, one doubt, sir.
Yeah.
Like,
hello?
I heard like somewhere we're using format dot something. What is that? Like, what is its syntax used for?
We'll talk about format when we talk about strings later.
Okay. No, like, for output itself, they are writing format, so I'm confused here.
Yeah, in output, you make use of the format method, which is a part of a string. Format is a method which is a part of string object.
Okay, sir.
All right, so local and global variables. We talked about duck typing, right? So do we have time? It's 10:35. Shall we stop here or shall we see another concept?
We'll see, sir.
We will see. Great. Okay. So continuing down, right? Our next point is, okay, we have seen all these points. Our next point is, please remember all Python types, right? Built-in types. Custom types, right? Custom types we are not going to explore in detail, right? But you can create your own type in Python, that is also possible. So what I'm trying to say is all types in Python are classes. Okay, now as somebody said, like, why can't you just write statements and try to understand what is happening, right? So I will try with that particular flavor also, try to show you that as well. So you can go to your REPL prompt, right? As I said, everything, all are objects in Python, right? You say type, right? Let us know what type itself is, right? So what is type of type, right? It's of class type. Clear. So this is an illustration using REPL to understand the language's features, right? Everything in Python is or objects, right? So if I say 10, what is type of 10, right? You can test it out here as well. But in the previous explanation, we saw this entire concept through a complete program. Okay. Integers and float intro, right? So let us have this with the main program again. So a is equal to 10, right? Print type of k, right? What is the type of k, guys? It's an integer, right? So what's the type of k here? It's a float.
Float.
Right, so integers and float, right? So let us try to multiply two integer values. So multiplying two integer values gives you a integer value. Multiplying an integer value with a float value gives you what?
Float.
Float, sir.
Right, gives you a float value, right? Now, what will happen if you divide an integer with an integer?
Depends.
Okay, now when you say it depends, yes, it depends upon the Python interpreter and the version that you are using, right? Now, unlike some other programming languages, or in fact in Python 2, if you were using Python 2, right, this will give you a float value.
Yes, sir.
Right? Sorry. That was a mistake, right? In Python 3, it will give you a float value, right? But in Python 2, it will give you the quotient, right? Now, if you run this particular program, you see 2.0, right? Whereas if I do a 4 here, right, it gives me a float value. Whereas in Python 2 and some other language, you get the quotient.
Okay, sir.
Okay, now if you want the quotient in Python, you can make use of a notation which is called as //. This is called as integer division. If you do this, you will be getting 2. Right?
Okay, sir.
This is called as integer division. And to get the remainder, you do a, tell me what?
Modulus.
Modulus or percentage, right? Is 2 again, right? So the remainder is 2. Okay, so that is modulus. This is called as integer division, right? And yeah, one important thing that you also guys need to remember, right, is to avoid floats whenever you deal with currency. It is always again considered to be a very good practice, right, to avoid floats for currencies or any other purpose that you can think of where accuracy is required. Now, what do you guys mean by this particular statement? Any guess? Why do you want to avoid floats for currencies? Let us try to understand that. Okay. Now, say for example, I have say, I'm dealing with currency, right? Say I want to add say 2.5, right, which is a float value with 2.5, right? Say 2 rupee 50 paise plus 2 rupee 50 paise, right? If that is the case, right? And if I do this addition, right? Probably I may get the correct output, 5.0. It is okay, right? So the point here is, it says avoid floats for currencies for and other purposes where accuracy is required, right? So do you mean to say this is not accurate? This is accurate. But why do you want to avoid? Right? Let us see with another example, right? Say for example, what do you guys think will be the output for say addition of two floats, say 0.4, let me say, right, say plus or say 0.2 plus 0.2, right? 0.2 plus 0.2 is how much? 0.4. And if I subtract this with 0.4, what do you think the output will be, guys?
0.0.
You expect 0, right? 0.4 minus 0.4, right?
Yes, sir.
0.0.
You get 0.0. Okay, fine, right? Now, this gets interesting, right? When you say, probably let us try to add one more 0.2, right? 0.2 plus 0.2 plus 0.2 is 0.6. And if I subtract that with 0.6, right, expecting that I should be getting 0, right? Let us see what happens and if things go right, right? You get something else. Okay, so this is one example. This is one example, right? Why I say that you should try to avoid using floats when you or whenever you deal typically with rupees and money, right? So when money is involved in your application, please avoid using floating point, right? See, this is almost close to zero, but this is not exact or accurate. Correct. So what I'm trying to say here is, see, Python or your machine's floating point processor, right, is kind of more precise, right, than being accurate, right? So whenever you have such kind of applications or whenever you deal with programs that deal with currency, right, please do proper decimal arithmetic, right? So that is the solution. So let us see how this could be solved using decimal arithmetic, right? So you need to do proper decimal arithmetic. So for that, either you can see, this is the part wherein probably you can explore later, right, of this custom types, right? So here I have written that, right? So you can have your own custom type created, right? And you can make use of that particular type to do the proper decimal arithmetic. That is possible, right? Otherwise, right, in Python, you can make use of a particular library or a particular class called as decimal, right, to overcome this particular precision, right, so that you get accurate results. Let us see how we can do that, right? So as I said, sorry, there is a library called as decimal that you can make use of, right? So let me try to illustrate that. You can import that particular library called as import decimal, right? Decimal is the name of the library or the module. And this particular module contains a class called as decimal, right? I have already studied that. So it contains a class called as decimal, which you can make use of, right? So how you can make use of is, say you can have a variable, say x, right, is equal to, you can specify the decimal class, right? The name of the class is decimal with capital D, right? Now this is a best practice or convention. This convention with capital D, right, is called as Pascal notation, right? So decimal is the name of the class. This class is available inside the library called as decimal. So you say decimal dot decimal. Let me see, if I put a dot, I get decimal. Yeah, there is decimal, right? So it is decimal dot decimal, and this constructor, right, takes in your decimal number, right? But this constructor takes in your decimal number in the form of string, right? Because this is how like decimal arithmetic is done through this particular class, right? It takes the decimal number in the form of a string and does the appropriate conversion. So let us put the decimal number in the form of a string. So in this particular case, say we have 0.2, right, which gets added, right? So let us put x is equal to decimal dot decimal 0.2, right? And similarly, let us have y is equal to another variable, decimal dot decimal with a value, say 0.6. Okay, and then let us replace this with y and add x plus x plus x. Okay, so we are essentially doing the same thing, but doing it in a proper way, since we are doing or we are dealing with a floating point, right? And we are dealing with, say, for example, currencies, right? Now, if you do this, right, and if we run the program, right, we get the output correctly, 0.0, right? So please keep this in mind, right? So whenever you deal with currencies, avoid floats, right? And try to have your accurate results, right? So for that, you either you can make use of the built-in decimal class, or you can make use of your own or design your own custom class.
Sir?
Yes?
Sir, in that x is equal to decimal point decimal, cancel that and write zero only 0.2, sir. And in y also, let us write only 0.6.
Okay.
Then what will happen to the output, sir?
You'll get the same thing.
We'll get 0.0, sir.
We'll not get 0.0. Let me show you. You mean this way, right?
Yes, sir. 0.6, sir.
Yeah. You get the same thing.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. So,
this why is it showing this output, sir? What mistake we did?
You did not do any mistake. In fact, it is correct only, but it is much more precise, right? So floating point processor takes or favors precision for accuracy.
Okay, sir.
All right.
Yes, sir.
So what you can do here is, I'll show you another method using the decimal. Since decimal, I said it is a class available in the decimal module, you can do this way also. You can.
So one doubt, sir. You written x equal to decimal dot decimal, no, sir. Is that a format or x syntax? I mean,
it is the format of object oriented programming, right? So in object oriented programming, right, you typically make use of this dot format, right? So this here in this particular case, this means that decimal is a class that is available inside this particular module, and this module has been imported here. All right.
Okay. So you're writing import decimal, which means you're using the class.
No, I am using the module decimal. Decimal is the name of the file or the module that is available built-in. It's a built-in module. This module may contain functions, this module may contain classes, etc., etc., right? It contains a class called as decimal, which I am making use of, right?
Okay. Clear, sir.
Yeah, the same notation or the usage can also be done this way, right? Since you are making use of a class decimal from the decimal module or decimal library, right? You can also do something like this. We will learn about libraries and modules later in detail, right? But please try to get the concept here. The same thing, we can do something like this from, right, the module name, which is decimal, right? From the module name, import, say, decimal, right? And you can do this, and rather than putting decimal dot, you can just say decimal. This is also correct. This way also you can do, right? Okay, guys. So please remember this point as well. Whenever you handle or deal with currencies, try to avoid floats.